Today we're going to talk about something that's near and dear to my heart, and it's something that gets often forgotten when guys are doing performance upgrades on their cars, or they're putting a motor in, or basically building a performance machine, and that is the air intake system. And I want to talk to you for a little bit about the difference between an air intake system and a cold air intake system, because a lot of times people call it one and the same, and they're actually not. So what I want to do is talk about what they are and how they work, and then we'll cover a number of tests that I did on cold air intake systems and why they're so important to me. Because as it turns out, a cold air intake system can decrease the charge air as much as an intercooler. Yeah, now you're interested, right? Yeah, that's what I thought. So let's get to our first discussion, and that's what is an air intake system. Now for me, an air intake system is anything that's basically in front of the throttle body. So that can include the factory filter, the air box, any sort of air silencer, because a lot of times the factory will use some sort of acoustic silencer in front of it, like the old 5-liter Mustang is a perfect example, but a lot of Hondas have those and a lot of other applications. All the inlet tube, the mass air meter, all of that stuff that connects from the filter assembly, from where you originally grab air from, into the throttle body. So that's the air intake system. So there are two things to think about when you're upgrading the air intake system. One is flow, and then the other is intake temperature. So on the flow standpoint, it's fairly easy to improve upon the power output of the factory system. And that's not because factory engineers don't know how to make power, trust me. They really do, and they're very good at it. But their criteria for making a factory airbox like on this Silverado is different than yours and mine might be. If we're looking for maximum power, that's one thing. The guys from the factory are never looking for that. They're looking for a specific power goal, that's part of it, but they have a lot of other goals that they also have to meet simultaneously. So it has to last a certain lifetime, it has to cost a certain amount, it has to be at a certain noise level, a noise level reduction. You know, they have a lot of criteria that they have to meet that's besides some sort of specific power level, and that specific power level is never all of it, it's never maximum power. And so when we upgrade the motor, the factory airbox, obviously, that was designed for the factory power level can become restrictive. So usually, and because of these other criteria, it's not hard to get additional power by upgrading the air intake. So bigger tube, nicer bends, you know, yada, yada, yada. A better cone filter, a radius entry, all that stuff is really good. And it can help improve the power. But, and while that's a good part of it, I want to talk about the cold air part of it. Because as we know, colder air is always better. Colder air has more oxygen molecules per given volume, more molecules equal more power. So the colder the air that you can get to the motor, the happier it is and the more power it's going to make. So a true cold air system is different than an air intake system. It's very common for people to put air intake systems on these and show power gains. But here's what happened, and this goes all the way back to the 80s when I was doing this kind of testing with 5-liter Mustangs and stuff, and all the way through Hondas and really everything, all the way up to the current LS and LT and basically Coyotes, everything, you name it. It's always the same thing. So back in the day, when a guy would put a motor up on a chassis dyno, a dyno jet or whatever he was running it on, and you'd do a cold air intake system, and this is very common on the Honda stuff that we used to do, is you would put the motor on the chassis dyno, you'd open the hood, you'd run the factory airbox, and then you'd put some kind of, like we called them, filters on a stick. It would be some sort of cone filter on a 3-inch tube like the RS Akimoto stuff that I'm going to do the test on. But you would put that on there, and then you would make another run, and you would pick up power. Now, in that instance, like on the Honda stuff, but it's that way on everything, you would pick up power for two reasons. One, you'd pick up power because on a VTEC motor like that, you would actually change the resonance frequency of the inlet system, which is actually part of the Helmholtz resonance frequency of the induction system, and the plenum. So it's plenum volume, it's a resonating plenum, resonating volume of the plenum. Actually, it's the plenum, the runner, part of the cylinder, and all of the stuff that's attached to the front of the throttle body, meaning the air intake system. So you change that resonating frequency. You could also change the flow, that was part of it, but the resonating frequency, it definitely made a difference in, especially on the Honda stuff, on the VTEC stuff in particular, but you would definitely change where the motor wanted to have optimized power. So when we'd run these short RAM intakes, like this RS Akimoto deal that we would run, you know, a short piece of 3-inch tubing with a radius cone filter on it, it would pick up power. And part of the reason it would pick up power is because of this change in resonance and the change in flow, but also because when we were doing the test, we were doing the test with the hood open. So think about how often you see a truck, an LS swapped Ford, whatever it is, doesn't matter what it is. Think about how many times you see that test run with the hood open. So, and then the gains, if you ever ran a hood open and hood closed test, the gains offered by having the hood closed, dramatically different. And that's air temperature. The air temperature is much different when you're doing a test like that than when you're not. So what you want to do is make sure that when you're doing a test, make sure that the hood is closed, because that gives a real world example of what the air intake does. Sure, it's nice to get, you know, we're going to change the Helmholtz resonance always because of the shortened stick. We can get improved airflow because of the radius entry and stuff. But you will never get the amount of airflow that you get or the temperature that you get from a hood being open like that. That's why I always insisted on running the hood closed when we were doing this kind of testing. And for some reason, it was foreign to a lot of people. And it kind of still is. Now, here's one of the tests that I did, because I took this like even two or three steps further back in the day. So I had this little Honda Civic. It was a 1.6 single cam VTEC motor, and I ran three different air intakes on it. So I ran these three different air intakes on the chassis dyno, on a dyno jet with the guys from Powertrain Dynamics and the show shop down there in Huntington Beach. So what I did is ran all these air intakes. We ran the short ram from RS Akimoto. We also ran the long deal that AEM sold. Now that was a smaller tubing, a 2.5 inch tubing, but it ran from the throttle body all the way in through the engine compartment and down into the fender well, which is a good idea because the fender well gets pressurized air and more importantly gets cold air. So you get cold air from that source, which works out very well. And it, as we'll show, there is a change in the power curve from the longer air intake than there is from the short air intake. As a matter of fact, when we ran this test on the dyno, unfortunately, I don't have access to this chassis dyno information anymore because this was years and years ago, and I didn't own those chassis dynos, and I don't have access to the computers. But here's what we know. When I ran the stock air intake, it made the least amount of power. When we ran the short open filter on a stick RS Akimoto piece, it made the most power. And when I ran the AEM long runner small diameter tube with a filter in the fender well, it made the second most amount of power. So the AEM air intake was better than the factory intake, and the RS Akimoto made the most power, especially at the top part of the power curve, which is not unusual. And that's the way it worked out. We've tested that 100 times. But here's what I did after that. I took all three of those air intakes out to our top secret test facility, which we're calling Area 52, out in Nevada, and I made top speed runs with them. And while I was making top speed runs, I also monitored the air intake temperature going into the throttle body. So I used a digital type K thermocouple, and since the runs took a long time, we had a lot of time for the air intake temperature to stabilize. So we made top speed runs, we made three each with each of the air intakes so that we'd make sure that there's no variation between, you know, each of the runs, that the motor wasn't heating, you know, that the car was consistent and the motor wasn't heating up or cooling down or any of that. So we made three runs with each one of them. And here's the interesting thing. The RS Akimoto was an open filter in the engine compartment. And so, as you can imagine, even though it works well on the chassis dyno with an open hood, it actually doesn't work very well when you're driving around. And that's exactly what this test showed. So when I did the top speed runs in my little Civic, not that it was tremendously fast, but there was a variation between each run with each air intake system of only 1 mile an hour. Basically, it means that the car was very consistent with each of the air intakes. So it was actually slowest with the RS Akimoto short runner open filter in the engine compartment, even though on the chassis dyno, that made the most power. Now we had a variation of over 3 miles an hour. So we know that this was making a difference. So with that open filter in the engine compartment, even though it made the most power on the chassis dyno, it was the slowest. It was also 28 degrees hotter inlet air temperature during the run. So it was actually fastest with the AEM intake, which made the second most power, and then it was Even the factory air box, which was grabbing air from that inner fender well, but was more restrictive than either of the two aftermarket air intakes. So the AEM made the most power, I mean, was fastest, then the factory one, then the open filter. And it just goes to show you that even though we show big power gains from one type of air intake system, that it doesn't necessarily translate into power when you actually go out and use it, especially with the hood closed. Now let's get to our next test. Okay, our final discussion and my final test that I'm going to talk about is about turbo motors. And this is both for Honda guys and LS guys, really everybody, because you're as guilty as everybody else. If you pop the hood on somebody's turbo combination, how often do you see a filter on a turbo setup, let alone some sort of dedicated cold air going to the turbo? Now, racers at the track, especially guys that put the turbos out front and put a big radius entry on it, they get it. They understand. They know that getting cold air to it is good, and also getting a nice radius air entry and putting it up in a high pressure zone where you're going to artificially feed the turbo like we did, and I'll tell you about our Bonneville adventure in the Civic in just a minute, but that's all good. But how many guys do you see out driving around with a turbocharged Silverado or almost anything, a Camaro, a Mustang, whatever it is? The turbo usually is just sitting there open. And that's a terrible idea. And I went through a lot of this with the 5-liter Mustang guys and with the Vortec stuff. And the Vortec was terrible because the air inlet system was like right back by the header. Same thing with the superchargers on the Corvette or any of those. We did everything that we could on our World Challenge car and our Bridgestone supercar to get dedicated cold air to the blower, because we knew that that's a terrible position for the air to draw, for the blower to draw air into. And that's the same thing with all the turbo stuff. Take a look at them. Pop the hood or look on the internet and see. All the turbos are basically just open to atmosphere. And that's a terrible idea. As I said, when the car is driving around or when it's just sitting there getting ready to race, your air temperature might be 100 degrees higher. Well, if you're only running 10 pounds of boost, the intercooler is only getting rid of about 100 degrees. So you've negated the intercooler because you don't have a cold air system. So make sure that you have a cold air system. These things are so important to me because they're the difference between really making power or the motor hurting itself and not hurting itself. I'll tell you a little bit about what we did with our Bonneville car. So when I ran the Civic out of Bonneville, we went 227 miles an hour. The cold air system was so important to me that we designed a dedicated system. So we had our turbo mounted where everybody mounts them on a Civic. It's right behind the radiator, basically. And now for us, it was offset to one side, and we had a small radiator on the Civic because we never had any problem with cooling. So it was actually behind a shield. But what I did was on this turbo, which was a 72 millimeter turbo, we mounted a big 4-inch duct and went and routed the ducting around to the front of the side of the radiator. Now on ours, it was even more important because we ducted the air in so that we got cold air to the turbo, which is always good, especially if you're running at wide open throttle for, you know, a minute and a half or 2 minutes, you know, going over 200 miles an hour. But the other thing that we did on this Civic is, because we were trying to minimize the amount of air and we were trying to control it, and we wanted all the air to flow around the car and not through the engine compartment, because when it does that, it creates drag. So what we did was we put fencing on everything. We made sure that the air was just enough air that we needed to go through the radiator and blocked everything else off. But in doing so, because the way that we fenced this and made sure that all the air was going through the radiator and not spilling around into the fender wells, the way that we had our intake set up ducted, we were getting pressurized air going into that filter. So at 200 miles an hour, we had over a pound of boost going to the turbo, which is obviously beneficial. Now, we never had a problem with making enough power to go as fast as we wanted to go. As a matter of fact, on that application, we only ran 17 pounds when we went 227 miles an hour, and we did that in the fourth mile. So the car was going to go a lot faster even at that power level. But it's very important, because that could be the difference between doing what you need to do and not doing what you need to do. And also, if you get, you know, if you add 100 degrees of charge temperature in there, that's very bad for everything. It's bad for power. It certainly can be bad for reliability. And it could be the difference between having an engine and not having an engine. I'm Richard Holdner, guys. Thanks for watching. Make sure to like, share, subscribe, ring the bell. I'll keep testing.